For this module, we want to quickly discuss genre. I'm hoping this is a term that you've come across in some of your other theater classes. The word is French, meaning kind, and therefore refers to kinds of theater. We're going to talk, as we graph them out, about four common genres: farce, melodrama, comedy, and tragedy. And as we talk about these, we're more interested in how we communicate to an audience in these different genres using plot and theme, because these will highly influence the designs that we'll produce. In plot, obviously, we're talking about the action of the piece, the actual storyline that carries us from the beginning to the end. We're going to use some terms to help define plot for these four different genres. Humorous. I think most of us understand that farce is meant to be humorous. It's lighthearted, we sit back, we relax, and we generally laugh. Melodrama tends to take itself very seriously and is one of the more common genres today. We're going to come back and discuss some titles in each of these areas. Comedy also tends to be humorous and therefore more lighthearted, but it has a bit more weight than farce does. And tragedy is our most serious of all. As we look at theme, it's not necessarily in the lines and it's not necessarily in the characters, but it's what the piece is about, what it's saying to us as an audience member. We would say that in farce, the theme tends to be fairly trivial. It's light. We're not there to learn something terribly deep by going to a farce. In a melodrama, while it might take itself seriously, we're probably also not going to learn any great theme from it. Most generally, a melodrama deals with good and evil, and most frequently, good triumphs at the end. Comedy, however, starts in a light mode and has humorous overtones, but generally speaking, there's some sort of message beneath the plot, something that we take home with us, something that we might learn about ourselves. And tragedy is serious in its plot, but it also has some sort of an important message that it might be bringing back to us. So let's talk about some examples of farce. For farce, we might think about some of the more farcical characters in the film industry. Robin Williams, Will Ferrell, Tim Allen, Jim Carrey. All of these actors tend to fall into that comic mode, one might say. And so some of the films that we see, A Funny Thing Happened on the Way to the Forum, anything with the Three Stooges in it, Ferris Bueller's Day Off, or Home Alone. All of these fall into that farcical mode. We weren't really expecting to go home with some important message. We simply enjoyed the humor and enjoyed the triviality of what we were watching. For melodrama, again, as I mentioned, this is one of the most common ones we see today. So as we think about Harry Potter, or any of the Marvel comic series, and X-Men, or Wolverine, or Iron Man, we're talking about melodrama. It is good versus evil, and good is most often triumphant in it. And we're not walking away, therefore, with some great message or something new we've learned, but it's serious and dramatic in the way it approaches itself. Comedy. Humorous, but there's some message underneath. So when we watch The Truman Show, there is a message underneath this story and something that we'll get out at the other end. While we might consider Will Ferrell a very farcical actor, he has done a couple of shows, Elf and Stranger Than Fiction, both of which had an important message or an important theme tied to them that made them comedies rather than simple farces. Tragedy isn't one of the most popular because it tends to be heavier, but some more recent tragedies would be Titanic, or La Bamba, or Les Miserables. All of those fall into the tragic mode, taking themselves very seriously and carrying a fairly important theme, something we can learn by watching them. it's important that as we look at some of the designs, we get a feeling for how each of these genres is presented. We'll discuss a lot more of this in class, but if these were our examples, we have Les Miserables be presented at the Pioneer Theater and the Pajama Game at the Roundabout in New York City in 2006, Into the Woods at Texas State University, San Marcos in 2012, and Oh Dad, Poor Dad at the University of Massachusetts Amherst in 1997. So if we were to look at the extremes first, where would we look for tragedy? We probably would look for more sullen colors. We would find probably a lot more detail and a little more weight. And so we probably would, as we've already mentioned, go to Les Miserables. Now, if we went to the opposite extreme and looked for farce, we're going to expect more color, more lightweight, perhaps less detail, because the detail isn't important, because there's not a lot of message there. And we probably would look back at Oh Dad, Poor Dad from the University of Massachusetts and notice that often the detail in a farce is extremely large, that things are blown out of proportion. Then it's a little harder, perhaps, to figure out melodrama and comedy. Comedy will tend to be a little more colorful as well, and we'll note that the Pajama Game is very colorful. The Pajama Game does have a message, and you'll note that the design is based in a reality. So we are in a pajama factory, and therefore we feel the cogs and the machinery of a pajama factory, and we note that most of the scenery pieces that are around us are made out of buttons or other sewing devices. So there is a reality, at least, to this comedic world, and there is definitely a message to be found. Into the Woods, another musical, we might say tends to have a comic mode, but in reality, it deals with fairy tales that tend to teach us, again, good and evil and the effects of them. Therefore, Into the Wood follows very strongly in the melodramatic mode, though you'll notice it's not as heavy as a tragedy. It's also taken itself fairly serious, but we'll note that there's a lot more weight to tragedy. If we looked at costumes, let's look again for the extremes. If we're looking for, let's start at the other end, farce. We're going to look for something very light that has lighter detail, a lot more color to it. And we're going to note that we see a production from University of Florida. We don't know what this production is. This is one of the promo images for their university, for the costume design program. In the bottom right-hand corner, we have Alice in Wonderland, the Walt Disney production that was produced in 2010. And we can see some similarities, perhaps, in some of the coloring. But we have to know the difference between comedy and farce happens to be with its theme, what is being said underneath. For any of you who have seen Alice in Wonderland, Alice does learn some things. So therefore, we might say that this show tends to be in a comic mode. But we almost so might find that in this production at University of Florida. We're not quite sure. Other than the fact that between the two, there tends to be more weight in the costume for the Alice in Wonderland character. There's a dark side to this character. A side that means there's a little more depth to this presentation than we see at the University of Florida. And the University of Florida tends to be lighter colored overall. There's just not as much depth to this production. So I might say that I would guess the farce is in the top left, the comedy is in the bottom right. We might also see some similarities in the costume presentations for the other two productions. We have Macbeth at the Shakespeare Theater Company in Washington, D.C. in 2011, in the bottom left. We can probably assume that we're going to be watching a tragedy. And indeed, in the costumes, we see strong contrasts and strong darks that support the entire production. And these characters, their costumes are closer to their original body shape, which makes them more vulnerable. And therefore, more can happen to them and it can be more tragic. The Game of Thrones, which is an HBO television series that began in 2011, it's got a nice medieval flavor to it, so it's got a strong period flavor going on. But if you watched the series, you understood that it was basically melodramatic in its presentation. And the costumes support that because we get one-color tones to each of the characters that really kind of denote who they are and what they stand for. And each of them is kind of a person in themselves. They're either good or they're either bad, and therefore it's fairly easy to pick them out and place them within their categories. That's a little more melodramatic. Lighting design. As we look at these lighting designs, we'll again look for the extremes. If we're looking for tragedy, we should look for dark, heavy things going on. If we're looking for farce at the other extreme, we would look for lightness. We're probably going to sense that in our two productions at the bottom of the screen. The Good Times Are Killing Me from the Maltz Jupiter Theater tended to be a fairly heavy production. Lots of message going on there. And Skipan from Seattle Pacific University in 2008 was based on The Misanthrope by Molière and had strong, strong farcical approach in its production. And the lighting tended to flatten it out and stay away from detail, whereas you'll see lots of detail in the lighting from the tragic production of The Good Times Are Killing Me. Because of the texture used in the gobos that denote a weight to that production. If we move to the top of our screen, now we've got to look for melodrama and comedy. It's Midsummer Night's Dream, but it is considered to be one of Shakespeare's comedies. And we definitely would say that the lighting has played with this by using quite a bit of color. Mainly what I would say the lighting is doing in here is silhouetting and framing the action that's taking place on stage, which helps trump up the action and therefore helps it fit better into that comic mode, we might say. And yet there's a level of reality based in this, and there's a level of depth of detail that allows comedy to happen and a message to be presented. The Baker's Wife from the University of Minnesota would follow, therefore, more in the melodramatic mode. And I think we sense this a lot, particularly because of the lighting design and some contrasts in the nice red psych and then some green color. There's opposites allowing us to make choices, asking us to make choices. A lot of lights and darks, highlights and shadows, contrasts that might make this a lot more melodramatic for us. In makeup design, here are some productions we can look through and get an idea of some extremes one way or the other. So in makeup, looking at these productions, The Women from the Circle Theater in 2011, Cat on a Hot Tin Roof, also from the Circle Theater in 2010, The Lion King from Disney Theatrical in New York City in 1994, and The School for Lies from the Chicago Shakespeare Theater in 2012. First of all, makeup-wise, we'll look for reality. The more natural feel, we might say, will tend to fall into the modes that are giving us most of the message. So a comedy and a tragedy will probably tend to look a little more realistic in its approach. If I were therefore looking at it and looking for and something that is more natural in the way it's representing life, I would look at Cat on a Hot Tin Roof. And knowing the script, I would understand that we're looking at tragedy in this production. The makeup is accenting that by helping sculpt the faces so that they work well on stage and allow the natural, stark reality of these characters to be projected on the stage. If we look for the opposite extreme, we'll be looking for a makeup that is going to be a lot more stylized, perhaps, and represent fun characters to an extreme. We would look towards The Women, also from the Circle Theater. There is some extremes, perhaps, in contrast between the characters, and a little bit of their makeup is pushed just a little bit, and we sense that there's a humorous tone going on here, but it's a little more realistic in its approach of its characters. The School for Lies from the Chicago Shakespeare Theater is pushing extremes of some of these characters. We see some shapings, not in just the makeup itself, but particularly in the hairstyles and how they've pushed these characters and made them farcical in their production. That enhanced by the costumes and the sets to some degree, but of the makeups that I'm seeing here, I would have to say that these characters are more farcical. There's a contrast in the characters and some fun characterization or caricatures, we might say, within these characters. The Lion King is an interesting piece because it's based in the struggle between good and evil again. We know that. We know we're dealing with a melodrama. So how can we denote this as melodramatic makeup? Melodrama is going to use caricatures again, whereas in this production we see represented not only in the makeup but in the headpiece that works with that in the kind of character this person is. It's a painted on kind of feel. It definitely takes itself seriously, but it is a caricature in itself also. Sound. Now, fortunately, we can actually experience some of these. So I want you to help me figure out, as we listen to some of this music, what we're listening to. Here is music from Forrest Gump. And I'm going to skip ahead just a little. The music starts simply. And now it adds another depth to itself. And yet another depth is added to the music. And if we had a chance to listen to the entire piece, we would feel more and more layers being layered on, telling us there's an important theme going on here. There are multiple layers of what we're going to see, but there's a lightness quality over the top of it, the innocence of Forrest Gump himself as a character. Therefore, knowing there's a theme, knowing that there is, I should say, an important theme, we can probably guess that with a light tone, this is more of a comedic piece. For Schindler's List, we instantly feel the depth quality of the music. We almost feel that we've started in the middle of a movement. We don't quite understand where we are. There's no real beginning. Something's been forced upon us. The music itself is asking us to participate, pulling on our emotions, principally by the choice of the instruments being used to play the music and for the longevity of the notes, how they're pulled across our heart. We feel a weight to both of these two pieces of music. There's a depth quality. So we would have to say that we're definitely in a more serious mode in Schindler's List. Probably we're looking at tragedy. Star Wars. We've already talked about Star Wars. We know we're in a melodramatic mode. But I want you to think about why this music is melodramatic. Does it help us denote stock characters, caricatures? Okay, definitely melodramatic music in my mind. I get a strong sense of uprighteousness, good trying to prevail. And lastly, music for the Pink Panther. Now, interestingly enough, I find similarities in this music as I did to Forrest Gump, but this one lacks a lot of depth. There's our farcical. Hopefully that helps in getting a sense, just in sound, how different music can help pull us into genre. So as we've looked at genre, we've noticed that in just the four major genres, there's an importance of that. There's a consistent understanding within the team that we know we're working within one genre. It could be very difficult if one part of the team felt they were in a comedy and the other was in a farce. So it's important that the entire team understands what type of genre they're working with and how they're approaching the show. It's important that however we approach that production, that we're consistent in doing it. We might determine in a production that perhaps the set is going to go a little more comedic, the costume's a little more farcical, and that's fine as long as we're consistent in doing that. It is more usual that a production will stay within its genre in all the areas of design. When we start mixing the genres, an audience can become confused. And that's what's important, is to remember our audience. If they're watching a farce, they don't expect to sit up and listen and watch detail. So if our design has lots of detail in it, we'll confuse them. They'll sit up and expect to be listening carefully to find some message when there isn't one there. So why are we presenting detail that denotes to them that they need to listen and pay attention? Hopefully this helps you in thinking about genre, thinking about how we take genre and personify it in the designs that we create.